Good morning. Welcome to all who are here today on this Sunday before Thanksgiving. It is also Christ the King Sunday. This is the last Sunday of the Christian year. Next year begins our new year with Advent. So I'm glad that all of you are here and ready to worship God together. As we look ahead to Advent, we are also planning for our Christmas lunch. It is scheduled for December 8th, and will be immediately following worship. Those of you who've done this before know how much fun it is and what a great day we have. Once again, Chef Kat is catering it for us, and we're looking forward to that. So it's time to get your reservations in. The easiest way is to either send an email or leave a message with the office, and we will do that. We just need a head count so that we know how much food to prepare. There is no cost to you. The donations are always welcome, and it's just a great time of fellowship together. Did I forget anything, Judy?
No.
Okay. There is a sign-up sheet in the fellowship hall, so you can also, that if you sign that up, that's your reservation. So it's on the food table at the end. So look for that. Also, with the beginning of Advent, we have our Advent series that we're going to be doing. It is on based on Adam Hamilton's book, The Incarnation. And or just incarnation, and we will be offering small group studies as well. I currently have three that I put on the calendar. If none of those work for you, talk to me. But the first one, it will be Monday, December 2nd at 11 a.m., and then Wednesdays at 4 p.m. at the Parsonage. Oh, the Monday one is in the Fireside Room. Wednesdays at the Parsonage. I hope you'll come and join us there. And then again on Wednesday on Zoom. So if you're out of town or if you know someone who doesn't drive at night but can't come on Monday morning but can get on Zoom, that's another way of doing it. If you would like a book, please contact the office, or you can order it off of Amazon, which is what we're going to do anyway. So please feel free to do that. This we had a wonderful week last week, and I want to say again thank you to Kristen for her wonderful message. And the preschool pictures are still up in the fellowship hall. If you didn't get a chance to see them, I hope that you will take a moment and do that. The office is closed Thursday for Thanksgiving, so but there aren't as many activities going on here during this week. I hope that you will have a blessed Thanksgiving with your family.
A few years ago, Ann and Jay headed up a church-wide video Christmas card. Raise your hand if you remember. We came through, we got pictures of everybody, and we did them in front of the windows, and we did them in people's backyards. We're gonna do a Christmas video again this year. What we'd like for you, and we sent out on the church order, or the epistle that comes out electronically and in paper, the four questions that we would like for you to choose one, write a sentence or two, how joy comes into your life. And we'll get a picture of you, and we'll put your name and your message underneath it that's going to go together with lots of wonderful music and lots of messages along the way about joy. Joy is what we're celebrating in this year's video Christmas card. And what's really nice about it, you can send your Christmas card to your people who live in Nome, Alaska, and wherever they live. So everybody can celebrate. And the object is every single person in church and on our rolls to have their picture taken. Now, I'm a picture person, Jay's a picture person, Anne's a picture person. So contact one of us. We're going to have lists of everybody and want everybody's participation.
Thank you. And just a thank you to all who came to yesterday for our church work day. We made so much progress, and it was one of those situations where many hands make light work. So thank you all for your help. There are also prayer cards in the pews. If you have a prayer need or concern, I hope that you will lift that up. Or if it's a praise, please share that with us as well. Now, let's get ready for worship, and I invite you to sit up, put your feet on the floor, and let's take a deep breath in. And then a deep breath out. And as we breathe in, let us breathe in the love of God. And as we breathe out our praise and thanksgiving for all that God has done for us. Let us continue our worship in music.
Thank you. The peace of the living Christ be with all of you. Let us stand and exchange signs of peace with our brothers and sisters in Christ. As we Spirit goes out in prayer, let us join together in song. Full circle to the celebration of the reign of Christ. We have witnessed the wonderful birth, the great healing moments, the teachings that have sustained people throughout the centuries. We cried in sorrow at the crucifixion and rejoiced with absolute joy on the sunrise of Easter when Jesus conquered our greatest fear, death. We celebrated the good news of the disciples as they risked everything to finally proclaim the good news to all people. And now, once again on this Sunday, we invite Jesus to enter our lives, to take his place in our hearts. Sovereign Lord Jesus, this is what we pray. Come into our hearts today and reign. Remind us that your kingdom is a kingdom of hope and light in which there is no darkness, fear, or sadness. You have called us to be the kingdom people, living our lives in the knowledge that peace, justice, and hope are not only possible, but can actually be the ruling factor of the world for those who follow you. There are many who do not acknowledge your presence and your name, Lord. But in your infinite love and mercy, you have still acknowledged and claimed them. Help us to be the kind of disciples that welcome everyone with words of kindness, that offer acts of mercy and peace to all in need, to proclaim Christ risen and glorified. As we bring before you, O Lord, the names of people and situations needing your healing and comforting touch, may we also open our hearts for that same healing and comfort. Remind us that we are never out of your grace and mercy. We know that you will give us the strength and wisdom to be true disciples. And we celebrate and honor you now and forever. We place before you, God, these who are on our hearts. We pray for Smiley Tierney, who is recovering from complications after a stroke. Prayers also for his wife, Lori, and their sons. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for our sister, Linda Seeley, as she continues to recover in rehab. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for Brooklyn a child who is fighting cancer again. Strength not just for her, but for her mother, as she continues to care for her. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Pray for Jackie and Steve's friend and neighbor, Jewel, whose husband passed away last week. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And God, we offer to you the praises. We praise former preschool attendee Addie Sousa, who is class president at George McFarland, and organized a food drive for the pantry and brought us 932 food items. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
And praise for Connie Waddington, our sister whom we've missed so much, who after a long hospital and rehab stay is finally home. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We pray these things, God, to you as we remember what you taught us and pray, our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Of you that don't know me, my name is Kristen Frisk, and I serve as the Director of Family Ministries here at St. Paul's. It is always my honor to present the time and the service that we dedicate to the children among us and for the child that resides within each of our hearts. And before I get to our message today, we have a couple announcements from Family Ministries. Our Seize Candy fundraiser is still going. You'll see flyers for this all over. There was another email reminder that went out to the congregation this last week. So orders for that will be due by December 3rd, and thank you to all of those who have already gotten your orders in. Next, our evening with Santa. That will be on December 9th from 5 to 7. It is a Monday evening. Santa is supposed to pay us a visit here. And we will have pictures for your family members with Santa, some goodies and treats and crafts for everybody. So there's an RSVP on there, so please let me know if you will be joining us for that. At this time, I'd like to invite up any of the children that would like to come watch the Celebrate Wonder video with us and the Family Ministries leaders. Show of hands, how many of you have missed Celebrate Wonder? I had a feeling. I did too. I see you, Steve. This week we are hearing about God's vision for a peaceful world. 700 years before Jesus was born, the prophet Isaiah foretold of a time of unprecedented peace. Isaiah described a world where animals that are usually enemies would live peaceably together. where there was no violence or pain, and where children could live in safety and free from fear. Doesn't that sound wonderful? In our video today, there is a wolf and a sheep living in peace together. Can you guys think of any other animals that don't get along? Cats and dogs, very good. Sometimes they do. Traditionally, right? How about a cat and mouse? Okay. How about a bird and a worm? Lions and hyenas? How interesting that today, all of these years later, we still long for and hope for a world that reflects God's dream. What might it be like to live a day in a peaceful kingdom? Why do you think a peaceful kingdom is important to God? Yeah, I'll say that one more time. Why do you think a peaceful kingdom is important to God? Let's think about that while we watch our video. Let us celebrate wonder.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Gabby. Come wonder with me. Wait, what's that? Wow, it's a wolf. Let me look a little bit closer. Is that a lamb next to it? Normally, I'd be really, really scared for the lamb. We don't see those animals peacefully next to each other. Usually, the lamb is in a lot of danger, but this amazing vision is God's dream of a peaceful world, a world where we can all live together and not be afraid, a world where a small child could put its hand next to a den of snakes and nothing would happen to the child, a world where we can live in joy and hope, not in fear and sadness. In this vision of God's dream for the world, different things that normally don't get along can live in peace with each other. This is beautiful, but sometimes I wonder if it can happen. I know this world is not perfect, and this vision seems like a perfect world. Even though it can be difficult to see, God imagines a world of peace for all of us. Remember, a blessing is something that God provides. And God's blessing is that God shares this dream of a peaceful world with us. God shares this vision with us so that we can work with God to make it real. Helping can look like a lot of things, like being nice when others are being mean. Maybe it's telling your family that you love them, or it's doing service and helping others when you can. Taking care of the earth is another awesome way to lead to God's beautiful vision. We all can participate in God's dream of spreading peace. I know it's hard some days, but it would be amazing if we could see this dream in our daily lives. When you participate in God's vision of peace, remember the picture of the wolf and the lamb. God's dream for the world is that we can all live in peace, and we can help make that happen. Now it's your turn to wonder.
How can we create a more peaceful kingdom? In Kids Zone today, we are going to talk about what our hope is for the world, and we will be in the fireside room after worship. You ready? Let's go. Time of year when we set aside time to intentionally give thanks. So as you present your offerings to God today, I invite you to do so. And as the plate comes by, offer a prayer of thanks to God for something in your life now. Let us worship God with our gifts and our offerings.
God, as we stop and give thanks this week, we are filled with joy and thanksgiving for our many blessings. Receive now what we offer to you in joy and thanksgiving, and bless it as you have blessed us. In Jesus' name, amen. Now I invite you, as you're able, to remain standing as we sing together, "Now Thank We All Our God." Pray with me. Loving God, still our minds and quiet our worries. Open our ears and hearts so that we might truly hear your word. Amen. So I have a thought that strikes me when we consider what this day is. Heaven is not a democracy. On this Sunday, we remember that and who the King is and who we say is Lord of our lives. A devotion I read once reminded me that we do not celebrate Christ as president with checks and balances and term limits. We celebrate Christ's sovereignty, Christ's absolute power over all creation. And Psalm 100 makes it clear that this is something to celebrate, to give praise for. God's reign is something we desire, something we long for, something we shout for. Now, Hebrew, interestingly, does not have a different word for thanksgiving. It's the same word as praise, because when you give praise, you give thanks, and when you give thanks, you praise. So it is also fitting that this is the Sunday before Thanksgiving, the day we have set aside to express our gratitude for all God's good gifts to us. One preacher states that gratitude is the fundamental Christian response to God. All life is a gift, and our salvation is pure grace. So all we can do in response is to sing our thanks and our praise. Our Christian life is not about guilt or obligation, but all about thanks, to responding to God's gift with praise and thanksgiving. Now, it is tempting to qualify our praise. We face real fears about the future. Will our savings be enough to last our lifetime? What about our jobs and basic security for us and our families? There's instability in key parts of the world where we have no control and often little influence. The climate and effects of changes on fires and storms and crops. Our future can appear more uncertain than ever. Well, I have news for you. People have praised God in much tougher times than we face. All we have to do is look to the holiday of remembrance that we are going to have on Thursday, the first Thanksgiving by the Pilgrims. You know, we tend to stop with what we learned in elementary school, that this was thanks for the harvest and the help that the native peoples gave teaching them how to plant native crops like corn. But it was more than that. We know that life was hard for those first immigrants, but maybe you don't know just how hard it was. They arrived as winter began, and they were far north of where they intended, in country that was harsh and difficult. They had inadequate supplies and provisions. The plants they had brought to grow crops with did not do well in the climate. Disease swept through the community. By the end of the first month, 10 of the 17 fathers and husbands were dead. Within a couple of months, only 4 of the 17 mothers and wives were still living. By Easter, half of the community had died. Only 3 families were untouched by death. And yet they set aside time and gave up precious food for a feast to praise and thank God for God's goodness to them. Or think about Martin Rinkart. Now, you probably don't know that name. He was pastor in a community in Europe that was besieged during the 30 Years' War. The people there in his village were starving and sick, and they began dying. Then the other pastors in the community died, leaving Martin as the only pastor in town. At one point, he was doing 50 funerals a day. He buried 5,000 people that year, including his own wife. And yet at the end of that war, he wrote a hymn, the hymn that we just sang that says, "Now thank we all our God."
Could you have sung, "Now thank we all our God," with heart and hand and voices, if you had endured what he or the pilgrims had? Why do we give thanks this week? Now, each of us has our own gratitude list. If you're like a lot of families and go around the table, you're going to hear lots of thanks for family members and things like that. But let's look at Psalm 100, because it gives us a broader perspective on why we should give thanks. First, the psalm tells us God made us. We are his, the sheep of his pasture. There's a little girl sitting on her great-grandmother's lap, and she asked her, "Grandma, did God make all of us?" "Oh, yes," her great-grandmother assured her. She said, "Did God make you?" "Yes." "Did God make me?" "Yes." And she reached up and she touched her great-grandmother's wrinkly face, and she said, "Don't you think God's doing a lot better job these days?" Science and technology open windows into the process of how we live and age. But in the end, creating life is a wonderful mystery that belongs to God. So give thanks to your Creator for making you. Second, the psalm tells us God loves us. The psalm says his steadfast love endures forever. God loved us before we loved God, before we knew God. We were created out of God's love, and we grow and live in God's love. God loved us before we knew there was a God, and even when we deny there's a God. Nothing can separate us from God's love, no matter how hard we may try. So give thanks to God for loving you. We belong to God. As the old gospel hymn proclaims, he sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. Consider the price God paid for you, which shows just how precious you are. Think about how you would care for something for which you paid such a price. How marvelous to know that we belong to God. So give thanks, because the King of all creation claims you. And then finally, God is all around us. Not some remote God off in some other world, but here and now, seen in the faces of our family and friends, seen in the faces of all that we meet. God is present in our lives when it is easy to give thanks, when there is a new baby among us, when the doctor gives us good news, when we see again the faces of those we love. But God is also present in our lives when we may struggle to give thanks, when we grieve the faces missing around the table, when we did not get good news from the doctor. For all who live in fear and despair. When I was in Jefferson, a member of my church went with a mission team from the conference to the little African country of Cote d'Ivoire. They were going there as part of the Nothing But Nets program. Do you remember us doing that to combat malaria? They were going to go distribute nets. And while they were there, they were taking advantage of all who would come to administer some basic health needs for vaccinating children, giving them basic medical care. And women brought their children from miles and miles around. The wait to get in and receive the nets and the medicine was hours long. Now, my member wasn't a doctor. She wasn't skilled in those things. She wasn't quite sure what she would do, but it became clear as those days lengthened that she could bring something to them, a bottle of bubbles. She would get the bubbles out and start blowing, and those children who were hot and tired and impatient would come running in joy. And the mothers would stand there with faces so grateful for just a moment of laughter and relief. God was present there, present in the nets, present in the medicine, and above all, present in those bubbles. Give thanks because God is here with us now. God made us. God claimed us. God paid the ultimate price for us, and God surrounds us with God's steadfast love every day. So let us resolve to give thanks and praise to God in all circumstances. We can understand why the pilgrims dedicated a feast to thank God for all that God had done in the past year. We can sing with Mark and Martin Rinkert and give thanks. And as you sit down with your family and friends this week to share your Thanksgiving feast, remember that you are surrounded by God's love. And if you are alone or missing someone you love from your table, remember that God is present with you and with that one you meet. For the Lord is good, and his steadfast love endures forever. Praise God, the King of heaven, from whom all blessings flow. Amen. Now, as we prepare to go and be thankful, I invite you to stand as you're able, and let's sing, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. Go and who will we be?
We go out into the world to be God's people.
And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit are surrounding us and giving us the grace to say thank you and praise his name. Amen.